Good morning.
How is everybody?
Yeah? Did y'all notice there was some weird stuff falling from the clouds outside this morning? Got everything all wet? I don't know what that was, but anyway, we're thankful for a little bit of rain. Just a few quick announcements we want to go over. The youth is hosting their taco bar today after church for second Sunday. So if you can hang around, it's always really good. If you like tacos, they do a nice job, and you'll support the youth group along the way. Also, we're going to be celebrating Braden's graduation from high school. I remember that 45 years ago. Yeah, it's been a while, yeah. I can't remember what I ate for breakfast yesterday, but I remember that. But VBS is tomorrow night, starts tomorrow night. It's Monday and Tuesday night. There's probably still time to sign up. If you've got anybody, kids, neighborhood kids, family, nieces, nephews, anybody that'd like to come join VBS, it's on our website. It's on our Facebook page. You click the link, or there's a little barcode or something you can scan with your phone. Anyway, there's still time for them to get registered. The Mountain Mission Truck will be here on July 16th. That's a Tuesday, so usually Sunday after church, and Monday and Tuesday till about noon are the drop-off times. So if you got some stuff that you need to clean out, you got old clothes, household items of all kinds is what they're looking for. So if you got stuff you want to donate to them, you can start getting that stuff ready. Trustees meeting on July the 9th, finance meeting on the 16th, administrative board on the 23rd of next month. Next month is meeting month, so if you're on any of those, be watching for when your meetings are. We appreciate that. And next Sunday is Fifth Sunday. Choir gets a little Sabbath. Christy gets a Sabbath. And Justin will be here to bring music next week. It's always a good time. Any other announcements? Did I miss anything? Where's Linda? I got it all? Woohoo! All right. Well, we want to, Braden, if you come up, we got a little something for you. That's just what he wanted to do, I'm sure. Little pen for you, and we got your Bible. Look at this, got your name. It's even spelled right, isn't it? Yeah, we got that's for you. As you grow up, when you're in high school, you experience a lot of new things, a lot of new experiences. But when you go off to college, that starts to happen about 10 to 20 fold. So, we hope that you keep that near you, and that you always remember your foundation. All right, y'all want to pray for him? Everybody extend a hand for him. Lord, we just want to give you thanks for this young man, all that he has done, all that he and his family have meant for this church, and all that he will do. As he goes off to school, he goes off to discover so much about himself and about who he is and who he wants to be. We would ask that your Spirit would be with him, support him, help him stay grounded, and lead him in all that he says and does. It's in Jesus' great name we pray. Amen. All right, now, if you'd stand and let's say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you.
First reading is Psalm 9:9-10. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Sing praises to the Lord enthroned in Zion. Proclaim among the nations what he has done. For he avenges blood, remembers. He does not ignore the cry of the needy and the afflicted. O Lord, see how my enemies persecute me. Have mercy and lift me up from the gates of death, that I may declare your praises in the gates of the daughter of Zion, and there rejoice in your salvation. The nations have fallen into the pit they have dug. Their feet are caught in the net they have hidden. The Lord is known by his justice. The wicked are ensnared by the work of their hands. The wicked return to the grave, all the nations that forget God. But the needy will not always be forgotten, nor the hope of the afflicted ever perish. Arise, O Lord, let not man triumph. Let the nations be judged in your presence. Strike them with terror, O Lord. Let the nations know they are but men.
Thank you, Miss Peggy. For our prayer concerns, Lisa's brother Todd is still in the hospital. This is what, his seventh week. He's still, I guess you could say, struggling with a bureaucracy, trying to get a pacemaker. They've decided to do it, but they've put it off a couple of times. But the good news is his kidneys are starting to function a little on their own, so maybe he's going to not require dialysis, and just please continue to keep him in prayers. What about Bill? Is he still... Okay. So tomorrow his CT scan on his lungs. Miss Billy is still dealing with some issues. I think she's got some more tests. She doesn't quite feel back to herself yet, ready to come back to church. I visited with, Fonzie and I visited with Martha Cooper and Mary Tinberg the other day, and I told Miss Mary, I said, if I can remember, she said she watches every Sunday. Hi, Miss Mary. I told her I'd give her a shout out because she watches so faithfully each week. They're doing well. Martha's Martha. She's a great lady. Any other prayer concerns we need to talk about? Yes.
His mother's at our house.
Oh, that's right. She's still with you all? Yeah. Auntie's mom, she's 90?
Nope.
80. Yes, Miss Doris.
Remember Charity because she fell and broke her ankle.
Oh, that's right. She fell down. Did she fall down steps? Is that right? Yeah. So we remember to pray for Charity. Yeah. Bob?
Yeah, I've got a friend. His name is David Hiddle. He's got one kidney. The other kidney is only working 15%. He just got out of the hospital. He was totally had liquid in his lungs. And his blood pressure is way below. Potassium is way high. And neither one of his red or white blood things are anywhere near our
room. Okay. And that's David Hiddle. Is that right? Okay. Yes, Diane. The pain still got her. Yeah. Okay. Gotcha. All right. Everybody keep Charlotte Clements in your prayer. She's still struggling with sciatica, and it's keeping her from being very mobile. And Miss Lindsay fell the other day, sprained her ankle. I said her and Michael probably shouldn't go outside. They fall down, so... Yes, Karen. Yeah, that's what I told him.
Miss Doris here fell right behind me.
Mm-hmm.
And she needs to see a doctor.
Uh-huh. So are you wanting us to encourage her to go?
Yes.
Oh. Everybody turn and stare at Miss Doris so she'll feel uncomfortable and go to the doctor. There you go. I think it worked. Anything else? Yes. for a catheterization, just to look around?
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay. All right. That's a lot to work. Yes, ma'am. I see one more hand. Yeah, her name's Linda, and her daughter's name?
Stephanie.
Okay. All right. I think that's a lot. We got everybody covered? All right. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, you heard those prayers. You heard the names that were spoken, and some of them remain unspoken. Some of them come right from the heart. But you are our Father and the one on whom we all rely. There are times that we shout your praises and glory in our times when our life is good and we're just full of joy. Other times we cry out in anger and frustration when we face life's challenges. But we know in our hearts that it's your love, your grace, your mercy on which we depend. We know that you are the one who causes the sun to rise and to set each day. It's your glory that we see in your creation. It's the majesty of the mountains and the majestic waters that flow across this place that we call earth. It gives us all life. And may we remember that we are all part of that creation that you care for and you love and you nurture. We give thanks for your Son and our Lord and Savior Jesus. Father, your love for all mankind is openly expressed in your Son, the one who came in the form of human flesh and gave everything for us, for our salvation, a humble and selfless act of love. It's this same extravagant, noble, generous act of love that we as your children are expected to emulate. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called to love even when it's hard. And Lord, we often think of our time together as worship. This is a time of refuge for us. This sanctuary has become our sacred place. It's our sacred space in which we can retreat from the secular world and find a place to lift up our prayers and confidence, and we find rest for our souls. But Lord, due to some recent decisions within our own denomination, it has some of us rejoicing in the changes and others feeling somewhat dejected. But Lord, we all need you in this time. We can't let this break our spirits. So many of us are wrestling with our own struggles, our own concerns. A lot of us are concerned about the future of the church, and Lord, we just turn to you and we turn it over to you, that your Spirit would guide us all as we maneuver through this season of life. Give us wisdom. Give us patience. Give us discernment. Give us comfort for our souls. But maybe most of all, give us a heart of love to see one another through this, and the grace that we need to help each other along the way. For in our human differences beats the one heart that loves you, Lord. And it's on that we can stand together. And be with us as we say this prayer. Jesus taught his disciples long ago, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Please stand if you're able, please, as we sing our song of worship.
Corinthians 6:3-10. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path, so that our ministry will not be discredited. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, in great endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love, in truthful speech, and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded as imposters, known yet regarded as unknown, dying and yet we live on, beaten and yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making many rich, having nothing and yet possessing everything.
Our ushers would come forward, please. Thank you, sir. I invite you to pray with me, friends. Lord, we give you thanks for this day, and we give you thanks for all that you have provided for us. We take a moment during our worship service, and we give back to you. We don't give to this church. We don't give to an organization. We don't give to a denomination. We give to you, Lord. May we always have confidence that in your hands, you will always do good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Wiped our tears away, stepped in and said,
You stand for the doxology, please.
Well, have you caught the running theme today? I mean, we even got a little rain to add to it, right? So before the choir sits down, can we stand for the reading of the Gospel of Mark? That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." This is the word of God for the people of God, and the people say, "Thanks be to God, indeed." Please sit, have a seat. Storms are powerful, aren't they? I'm fascinated by them. Such a gentle breeze outside, sun is shining now, so there's probably a gentle breeze blowing. But that breeze can just build and build and then bring in the rain, the lightning, the thunder. And they can do, sometimes they don't do hardly any damage, if any damage at all. But other times, man, they can knock a building down and take out a town. Years ago, I was heading down to Florida with some friends, and we were just north of Atlanta, and it was about 2:00 in the morning, and I was in the back seat asleep. And when the rain just came crashing down on the roof, and it woke me up, and I kind of raised my head up and seen thunder and lightning, and all I heard from the front seat was, "I can't see the road." And I said, "Well, they don't need my help." I went back to sleep. But later on that day, the sun had come up, it was like 7:00, and we heard on the radio that storm, and where we were at, 5 people had died that night. A storm can affect many lives. It can cause chaos for some, and it can leave others unscathed. A lot of it depends on how well protected you are. And what kind of protection you decide to take ahead of time. And sometimes you can have that protection, or think you have protection, and you don't. How many times have you heard of somebody say they're going to ride out a hurricane, been doing it for 50 years, and they keep doing it until that one time that they don't? And have you ever been as scared as the disciples were, though, in a storm? maybe a more important question to ask out of that scripture is, do you think God has ever been as disappointed in you as it sounds like Jesus was in his disciples? I mean, we kind of have an advantage on the disciples because we've got the New Testament. And they were kind of living the New Testament out, right? But from Jesus' tone, I kind of get the feeling that he thought that they'd been around him long enough to, have some faith in him. And sounds like he was kind of disappointed. And that's not the first time that he'll be disappointed with them. And I don't think Jesus ever led them astray. Not from the beginning. I mean, if Jesus was going to do something, if he said he was going to do something, then that's what he does. I don't ever remember him speaking mistruth. So, and at the beginning of this scripture, he says, let's go to the other side. So we know that it was Jesus' ideal to head over there. So shouldn't they have known that this trip was going to end on the other side? That it didn't matter what was in the way, that he was going to get through it? So let's unpack this a little bit. Here we have Jesus. He's been teaching and preaching all day. And you remember last week, Pastor Matthew talking about the seed, sowing the seed, and the mustard seed. And Jesus standing in a boat teaching that day. Well, this is the same day. So he's been out there preaching and teaching all day. It's probably hot. Out in a boat. And one of the reasons that he stands out in the boat is, not only is there a lot of people there, but sound kind of, on a calm lake, sound to bounce off. In fact, a couple of days ago, I was out by a small lake, and I heard some people talking, and they were about 100 yards away from me. But I could hear them pretty clear. But even still, Jesus was teaching to a large crowd, so he's still talking loud. And imagine how you would feel at the end of the day like that. End of a day, preaching, and the heat beating down on you. You probably, I mean, just look at the heat that we've had the last few days. How tired are you by the end of the day? So they get in this boat, and they take off because that's what Jesus wants to do. He wants to go over across the way. And this storm comes up, and suddenly it's dark. The winds pick up. The waves are crashing against the boat. The water is coming in over the bow. And these guys are fishermen, right? At least a lot of them are. So if they're scared, it must really be something to worry about. So you got all this plan and going, are we going to sink? Are we going to make it? And then there also, across the way, is basically the land of the Gentiles. And just look to your left and right and see what they were heading to. Because that's what we are. So, and there was also rumors of, demons and things like that. In fact, in the next chapter, that's what they end up facing. But the boat's swaying, bobbing up and down. The wind's coming over, or the waves are coming over. And they go to Jesus, and they don't say, teacher, can you give us a hand? Can you help us out? They don't say, teacher, we trust you, but we need some help with our faith. Now, they pretty much go and they make an accusation and they say, don't you care if we drown? And what do you think the disciples are wanting Jesus to do? Because from the end of that scripture, calm in the storm doesn't seem like that's on the list of things that they were wanting. I mean, were they expecting to help row the boat? And what kind of conversation was going on before they approached him? Do you think maybe it was something more like, well, how's he so calm? How can he sleep through this? We're panicking here. And he's just laying there asleep. Do you think maybe they were looking for what I like to call sympathy fear? It's something I've seen time and time again when I was working at EMS. You have somebody panicking in a bad situation, and they're running around, and there's somebody next to them or in the same room, and they're not panicking, or they're not panicking enough. So that the person that is panicking gets upset because they don't know what to do. They have all this built up tension in them. And if you don't recognize it, that fear that they have can be transferred to somebody else. They start feeling that anxiety. And if you have a whole group of people, oh Lord, watch out. And the only way that you can head that off is if somebody steps in, takes charge of the situation. And that's what we see Jesus doing. He rebukes the wind and he calls out, quiet, be still. And the weather calms. And then what's Jesus say next? Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? And I kind of get the impression it was in a disappointing tone. But in verse 41, we can see that some reality kind of started to sink in. Because man, they start asking, well, who is this? Who can do this? And up until that time, the only one that could do that was God himself. So maybe their faith grew a little bit that day. And I don't want to be too critical of the disciples. Again, we know the story, and they're living it. But wow, really. Asking Jesus if he cares. I mean, that's what they were saying. They're asking the Son of God if he cares about them. But don't we do the same thing? We're in a bad situation. And if our faith isn't strong, isn't there a time that we've gone and said, Lord, why am I going through this? Why is this happening? Don't you care about me? I'm drowning here. Help me out. Do you think maybe he's saying, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? How often do we let fear take over control of our life? When we're faced with hard times, with perilous times, with chaos. What kind of Christian are we when we let the situation of the flesh dictate what we say, do, and feel? It could be that we're human, that we're imperfect. I grant you that. But do we want to live our life with that excuse? Do we want that excuse to dictate how we live? And do you really want to live your life in fear every time something comes up against you? Every time you say face something hard? Because our faith isn't always where we want it to be. Our faith isn't always where it needs to be. But faith is not not always instantaneous. And we're in a religion that is based on faith. We have faith that Jesus is our Savior. We have faith in God. We have faith in the grace that He's given us. But when you meet somebody, you don't have instant faith in them, right? It takes time to build up that faith, because faith involves trust. Faith involves a relationship. And it can take a while. For some of us, it takes longer than somebody else, and there's nothing wrong with that. We're all different, right? But I kind of look at faith, the faith that we have, especially when we're facing a storm, it's kind of like sitting in a car driving along with the sunroof open and wondering why we're getting wet when we go through the storm. You know, we're driving through, we're so wrapped up in ourselves, we don't even think about asking God for help. God might be in the back seat, or we may not even let Him in the car. But we're driving along, and the problems are pouring in, and the water gets up to the ankle, and a little anxiety starts to set in. But we're proud. We'll take care of it. So we grab our coffee cup, and we start bailing out that sunroof window as it's coming in, trying to handle everything on our own. And then the water gets up to our waist, and that's when fear sets in. But we're still bailing along, trying to get that water out, and we're still wrapped up in our own little cocoon, not paying attention to anything, not realizing that all we have to do is roll a window down. And then the water starts getting up to our neck, and we start to feel lost. Feel like there's no hope. Maybe we've asked God, maybe not. A lot of times we'll ask God and not even listen for the answer. But man, when it starts getting up to your nose, then that's when we'll surrender everything, won't we? Lord, help me. I'll do anything. I'll go to church every Sunday. I'll read my Bible every day. I will pray morning, noon, and night if you'll just help me. And usually what will happen then is a couple of things can happen. Sometimes that storm can just dissipate, and all your fears and everything just roll away. Or maybe God just opens the door, lets that fear and anxiety out, and tells you to move over and let Him drive, because this is something that you've got to go through. But He is there with you every step of the way. But you've got to give Him control. And something else that might happen is God goes to open that door, and you go, quick, and lock the door on Him, because you don't want to face the changes that you might have to make. You don't want to face that you might have been wrong. Giving control over to God, over to Jesus, over to the Holy Spirit can be a hard thing to do. And I know that's a silly analogy, but is it any more sillier than knowing that Jesus Christ died for us and we ignore having a close relationship with Him and His Father and the Holy Spirit? Is it any more sillier than having access to prayer 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, access to the whole scripture, and not take advantage of it, and not use it? And is it any more sillier than having access to a church full of people that are imperfect, but are trying to do better, that are seeking the love of God, and that are asking and willing to give that love to others and to help you out, to help you get closer to God, Jesus, and everything, and to help you have a better life? Is it any more sillier to have access to all that and not utilize it? Or at least not utilize it faithfully. And I understand life is busy. After I retired the first time, I was like, well, I don't know how I had time enough to work. Because life is just so busy. But come on. We're talking about prayer. Just taking 1 minute when you get up. It doesn't even have to be a minute. Start now and say, thank you, Lord, for this day. And throughout the day, if you come across a problem and you may need to make a decision, it doesn't hurt to say, Lord, can you help me? Help me make this decision that'll best benefit you. Because whatever benefits him is going to benefit you. And before you go to bed at night, and prayer is a two-way communication, too. Because you need to listen throughout the day. Because sometimes God gives you the answer in other people and in other situations. But the Bible thing. Oh, my gosh. Read the Bible every day? Do you know how much time that takes? Well, if you don't have the time, they've got an app for it. You can walk. You can do laundry. You can cook. You can drive. You can do whatever. And you can listen to somebody reading the Bible to you. And it's free for the most part. They even have devotionals that you can listen to. We live in a time where information is at our fingertips, and we don't think anything about looking up a car part or looking up a recipe or looking up your favorite song. But how often do you look up a piece of scripture? How often do you look up, is there anybody that's in my situation that God has helped? Because there's a lot of people out there that God has helped. And these people will tell you what a difference he's made in their life. Kristen? And I don't want to sound like I'm harping on, you know, if you're out there reading your Bible, if you're out there praying every day, if you're out there getting as close of a relationship as you can, then more power to you, and I say hallelujah. The only thing I ask of you is that if you've got that kind of relationship, then share it with people. Because that's what we're called to do. But wouldn't you like to have a better relationship with our Lord and Savior before you hit that storm, before the problems pop up, before life just throws you that curveball that you can't that you just don't know how you're going to negotiate. Wouldn't a close relationship then and there be better than a casual relationship? So if you don't have that relationship, today I ask you, and if you're watching at home, I'm talking to you too, look up a few Bible verses. Say some prayers. See if getting closer to God, even if it's just a little bit, doesn't improve your day. And if it does, well, then why not keep on improving? Why not keep on reading? Why not keep on praying? Why not keep on coming to church and getting that really, really close relationship? So when things just really get messed up, you can stand there and say, Lord, I need your help, and I'm giving it all to you. And you'll get me through this. Because I know from personal experience that I would rather go through a storm with God, with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit in me, than to face something without Him. I can't even fathom anymore of facing something hard by myself. Amen. Well, if you will now stand for our song of invitation.